The Extinction Agenda, comics and movies of the 80s, 90s, and more.
Backwards. Yeah, all right. So welcome to The Extinction Agenda. This is a special feature. We would very much like for it to be a regular special feature, but, you know, whatever. Fucking COVID. We're going to call it, what are we calling it? No Vetoes?
We're calling it the No Veto Special. It's like Big Brother, only without vetoes.
Well, I don't know enough about Big Brother to know if there's a veto in that. But
there is a veto sometimes, yeah.
Okay. It's exactly like my colleague describes. I know I couldn't say one way or the other.
Basically, we both picked movies. And
yes.
Despite the sour taste in each other's mouths, you still watch the movie and then talk about it.
Right. Now, I'm going to say for this phase, we were real kind to each other.
I'm going to say, this was a bit of a fluffer.
Yeah,
Nobody pulled out the big guns. No three-headed shark attack.
Yeah, because I don't know about you, but I mean, like, once that arms race gets started, it's a race to the bottom. It's a race right to the bottom. So I was like, I'm going to let him go first.
I think there's going to be an air of niceness for indefinitely. I don't think anyone's going to pull out like you pull a Werner Herzog docu on me, you're going to suffer. You're probably going to watch a Will Ferrell movie.
Well, so we're going to see how this goes, but the rules are no vetoes. The movie is presented to the other party without argument and watched and then discussed.
I'm just going to put this out there.
Yeah.
I don't have, you know what? My credentials are a little sketchy at the best of times, but I'm going to say I worked at Rogers Video and Blockbuster Video in my lifetime, which I believe makes me a movie expert.
It makes you the second coming of Roger Ebert, for sure.
So you're
on deck. Like once that is he still around or are you?
Did they both pass away?
Oh, the other fellow. I don't know. I do not know the answer.
If one of them's still kicking around, I mean, it's impressive.
Yeah, I don't even know Leonard.
He's gonna be 100 at least.
Yeah, who knows? Anyway, so you're off the hook until that guy passes.
That's good.
And then, so we're going to do the Fast and the Furious first.
Yes. The original.
Yeah. 2001, directed by Rob Cohen, written by Gary Scott Thompson. Two interesting things about that. Rob Cohen, unsurprisingly, was the director of Triple X, another Vin Diesel.
Sorry, man, you got me snorting there.
it's like he was taking another shot at that movie, you know? Like the Fast and the Furious is like a definitely, for all intents and purposes, a sequel to Triple X. And then, and Gary Scott Thompson, he Vero Evan did a movie called Hollow Man, which was basically the Invisible Man story. It's written by the Fast and the Furious guy.
Really? Yeah, I'm aware of Hollow Man. I believe it was Kevin Bacon.
Yes, with the Kevin Bacon, 2000. So the movie prior to this, he went from Hollow Man to Fast and the Furious. I don't know what to make of that. Other than he knows,
it doesn't feel like a step up, but it's not a step down.
No, it doesn't. Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's more of a lateral move.
I'd never seen the first movie, or I'd never like sat through the whole thing.
Really?
You know, maybe I saw the bits. I saw little snippets. I feel, but I never sat down and gave the whole thing a gander.
Like a fair go.
Yeah. Yeah, you were familiar with this before me?
Yes, I've seen it, a couple times.
Yeah.
Probably closer to when it came out, and you know, I don't think I ever owned it, but I didn't shy away from it, couple of them.
Right. I came in later. I came in Fast and the Furious 4. Just before, I think. I think it was Fast and the Furious 4, whatever it's called, Fast Furious 4, something.
Too Fast, Too Furious, maybe.
Too Fast. No, that's the second one, isn't it? Oh, fuck. Who knows?
Oh, yeah, you're right. You did, yeah. You got me there.
Yeah. Too Fast, yeah. Written by the same feller, or at least he provided the story.
Out. I think number 4 is Fast and Furious.
Yeah, that's where I'm in.
Yeah.
My jam. Because that's when Justin Lin came in as director. And it was getting some hot fire at that point. So I zoomed on in. But these movies, this movie by Rob Cohen, I don't think it's a lesser product than anything that comes out later. It's a little bit less exaggerated. You know, like they haven't shown all their cards yet on what these movies are going to be about. And so I don't think they have to be really as ostentatious as they'll go later. And these movies are pretty fucking showy.
Yeah, yeah, I agree with that. I think this one was more like a sort of a show of family and duty, you know? Sort of a...
Yes.
Like a... I don't know. It had to... There was a great character development. There was a real slow build. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It actually, you know, there wasn't a lot of action to speak of. There was tension, but the script was good. I mean, the Vin Diesel character was obviously Dominic. Like, yeah, Dom was vaulted into, into like a real power position. He's frightening, you know, for a guy that's not that tall.
Vin Diesel?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he has a stupid charisma, which works for him. And I know that sounds like really backhanded, but... Like, and I don't think he's a stupid person, but he's just kind of he plays the goofy strong guy with a heart of gold. He plays that real well.
Yeah, he has what I was going to say too is because like initially in the onset of the movie, I was like, this sucks. Like, I'm not going to enjoy it. And kind of as the movie progressed, Vin began to shine actually because he was. I don't know. He just committed to the role. He was so committed to like I believed that he believed he was that character.
Yeah.
If that makes sense, like he didn't, he never like wavered at all. Like he was deep in that role, you know, and that was bizarre kind of.
Yeah. It suits him. Yeah. It, cause the character of Dominic, he's like, I didn't expect him to, like, I was unaware of his backstory in the other movies I'd seen. And there's this, like, he watched his dad burn to death. Like, he was just some kid who was going to be really good at racing, who, as a consequence of trauma, beat the shit out of someone. And then was no longer able to be a legitimate racer. And so he's kind of scarred, but he's a good guy at heart. They do a good job of selling that, even though I'm still, you know, the things he does, maybe good people don't do those things, but.
Well, they did a lot of work to establish that he beat a bad man to death.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Which, and that's, so spoilers, everyone, that's halfway through the movie after there's a lot of talk about him being a loose cannon. Who beat a man, you know, after they said, like, they emphasized it so much that, like, they made a point of saying it almost verbatim twice. Because Brian, played by Walker? What's the guy's, Scott Walker? No. What's the guy's name?
The Walker Kid.
The Walker Kid. What's that guy's fucking name?
Paul Walker.
Paul Walker. There we go. Yes. And... When I make my notes, I'm like, I'll never forget Paul Walker, who everybody knows that guy's name.
Yeah, and he passed away in a fiery crash, which was weird, considering his lifetime franchise. But
yeah, little irony there. They just make a point of saying it to him twice, so you get a little reversal or whatever.
They were forever jerking you around in the script too. Like, you knew Vin Diesel was the ringleader. The Dom here was the ringleader of this mm-hmm. racing faction that was like robbing
trucks,
Panasonic TVs.
Oh yeah, my first note is this movie brought to you by Panasonic, Toyo Tires, NOS. Because yeah, they really make a point of
they had some heavy duty product. Yeah, Corona. Yeah.
Like, yes, yeah, you can drink whatever you want.
Yeah, there's no way you go to a party with those kind of crackheads and villains and everyone's drinking Corona. That's odd.
Well, no, and they explicitly said, you can drink whatever you want, but it's got to be Corona. That's a quote, more or less. Let's say paraphrase. So, like, they needed to make ends meet when they made this movie.
Yeah, yeah, and that's fair. That's fair. I'm not a hater on product placement. That's fine. You get, throw it in there.
It didn't get in. Like, you notice it because you're like, I notice it because I'm cynical.
But the NOS product placement, I feel like, got in the way a little.
I need NOS. Like, that's a quote.
That was a lot. There's a lot of NOS. Yeah. Like, yeah. More than the amount of NOS needed for a product. Unless NOS gave them all the money they needed for the movie, I don't see why that there was that much NOS. But that's fine.
Yeah. a lot of cars. You know, like, I don't know what you have to do to get those fucking cars. Weird thing, I didn't really go down the rabbit hole, but I almost did. I started looking at the cars, like websites about the cars of these movies.
Mm-hmm.
They're all Japanese cars, like Mitsubishi and shit like that.
And I know the main car, the orange car that mm-hmm. sort of gets rebuilt is a Toyota Supra. And that's a rare and odd car, and to be built like that would be extremely expensive.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if they would borrow it and then just smash up some like body kit cars. Those like crappy special effects. Those little Honda Civics though, those are fine. But then they bring in the American car later.
At the end.
Yeah.
Like, and that's his dad's car, you know, and it's like, I'm really American, guys.
That's the American muscle, yeah. Let's get rid of these little Japanese cars.
It's still an interesting, like, it's a real, you know, we would say it's a techer aesthetic. Like, this is about tough guys who engage in high crime and are, you know, like, they're criminals and outlaws, but they ride these, like, really, they try to man up. I don't want to call them effeminate cars, but they're definitely not muscle cars, right?
You know, like exotic cars.
Yes, yeah. Then they're like riding fucking ponies, you know, like they're unicorns. They're coming in on their like magic, and it's just an interesting contrast, and I don't know what to make of it, other than like I found myself thinking about drag racing, you know. I found myself like there's even sort of a quote where he's like, I used to drag here. And I just thought about the ambivalence of that term. This idea that, you know, what people would have said cross dressing and then stepping into these cars, which are not stereotypically masculine. I know this is like it's kind of a stupid idea, but it was something I ended up thinking about.
No, that's interesting.
I guess
because even Vin has kind of a little girly one there at the beginning.
Yeah, yeah. And
until he brings out the American man boss.
Well, they've got like their color-coded red, yellow, blue, white. They're just so bright. It's just not what you think of when you think of tough criminal thugs. It's something that you think about with like, I don't know, let's put it under the category of like metrosexual or something like that.
Yeah, would you drive a car like one of those?
I would not drive a car like one of those. Although that's going to sound like homophobia coming out of my mouth.
Which one would be your car?
Not a muscle car. Strangely, I've been thinking about this more than I normally would as a consequence of like watching the movie. I see cars now and I'm like, is that my car? What's my car, man? I don't. I just don't see myself in any of these cars, like the with the spoilers and the, you know, like the fuck, I don't even know the terms. Just cars with spoilers. That's not my scene. Yeah, but yeah, I don't. I mean, yeah, I don't. I just don't see myself comfortable. But maybe I'm wrong. You know, like a lot of things, you don't know until you try.
Yeah, you. Yeah, if you had that orange one, I think you'd change.
I need a $100,000 car stat.
I wonder if those cost that much.
Well, they never talked. No, go on.
That was one of the aesthetics of the movie, I think, too, was that they were hijacking using these. What were those? Those were a specific type of Honda Civic. I want to say it was 1992 or 1993. It was a specific model, and it was really mass produced, and modifying it for additional horsepower and parts was cheap and like really effective. And they popularized that Honda Civic. And then people did all this goofy stuff to their Honda Civics as a result of the movie and stuff. But it was, I think that was one of the allures, was that like you could do this kind of cool stuff to your cars, you know, like on the cheap, with like, you know, like lower amounts of money and stuff like that. You know, it wasn't,
right.
Some of them were fancy and expensive, like the Triad guy they were battling or whatever had a more expensive vehicle.
Johnny something. Yeah, well, what I was going to say.
Johnny Tran.
This ties into what you're just saying. Like they never talk about the car itself. They never say Mitsubishi, Honda, you know, like none of those names come up.
Although they did a couple times, yeah.
Oh, okay.
They said that Johnny Tran had over 100,000 in the under the hood of that Honda 2000 or whatever.
Ah, but okay, so that's the example I was gonna use though. Like, they don't really emphasize, like, let's reverse it. He never says like he's got a Honda, you know, with $100,000 under the hood. It's like he has $100,000 under the hood, and it happens to be in that Honda.
Or I don't even know if he says Honda. He might say 2000, which is just like the model of that Honda. So he says, okay. I think he has got $100,000 under the hood of that 2000. So that's like techie talk, right? Like you wouldn't even know what kind of car that was, really, if you were like, you know, if you're not like an enthusiast or whatever.
Yeah, and I don't think that, and it doesn't matter to the movie, is the point I'm trying to make.
They didn't emphasize a lot of that.
Yeah, it's all about money. It's all about like how much, and it's typical gang behavior. Like how much money's on that hood? It's like that's the question. What's under the hood? Not like what is the car that you're driving? Like maybe they'll say that's a nice car you have, but you know, I'm sure there's a number of conversations where it's like pull down your pants and show me your Johnson. Like that's what this movie's about, you know. And which gets me to the point, you had said this is about honor and duty, and I thought of this movie. And it kind of tied into what I was thinking earlier with unicorns and ponies, is like this is a movie about jousters, people who engage in these ceremonial contests against one another. It happens to take the form of racing, but it could just as well be two knights jousting one another.
They do. There's fist fighting frequently.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
There's gun fighting frequently. It's just a pissing contest.
Yeah, constantly. But it doesn't – it's toxic, but it manages to be that way without being obnoxious. I think there's a lot of people who would disagree with the sentence I just said. but I think still I'm right. You know, because it could have been so much worse. You know, like just if they – even if they had sworn more, like they very rarely swear. It's a very clean movie. I might be.
Well, they're honestly, this first installment, there's something pure about it. It's not tainted. They didn't know that they were gonna knock this out of the park. This was pretty low budget. I mean, from what I can see, like in terms of like a box office Hollywood movie, We went with
36 million.
Yeah,
I don't know what that is in 2001, but
that is. I want to say that's not an outstanding budget.
No, yeah, it's not 200 million, or whatever. So
yeah, so they did what they had to do. They had a fairly fresh cast, like of not super duper established actors, not unfamiliar actors, but you know. Like Paul Walker was a baby, so was Vin, yeah, so was Michelle Rodriguez. Everybody was very young.
Yeah, and I don't think any of them this is theirs.
Vin Diesel's breakout roles, right?
Yeah, let's say Vin Diesel's a star at this point. Like he is an established property. He carries this movie, but he this is the thing that makes him. I'm going to say a superstar. Is it fair to call him that?
Yeah, I would say he's a
he's
an action star, like an action superstar, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anyway, yeah. The movie is. I just don't feel like you could have 100% said flip this script to somebody and been like, "This is gonna be it. Like this is gonna hit, right. Knock it out of the park." It was a crapshoot. Like they ran in with a low budget. They had a, you know, whatever the creative team and directors were, they didn't know what they were going to have here. So there's just something like nicer, like more pure about that, like comparatively to the rest of the franchise, is that just like this one, they didn't really know. So it just seems like the story was cohesive. Everybody kind of brought their A game, you know, they were just doing their best, you know, and it just happens to kind of be like a weird, I'd almost say it's like probably gonna like filter down into kind of a weird culty movie, you know, like later on. But
that's pretty likely given its popularity. You know, like 20 years from now, no one's really gonna give a shit about the sequels. But maybe it'll be like Friday the 13th, or another. Which is strange to say that out loud. You'd have to compare it to like a horror franchise, and I don't know if that's I can't think of any other analogy though. I liked the movie. I thought I didn't even mind the pointless racing. Like when there was wrote down like at the 1 hour mark, there's really a super pointless race against a guy at a Ferrari driving a Ferrari at a red light.
That was awesome.
It was awesome. The racing in this was pretty cool, even though like it got a little CGI when they went super fast. You could see the computers come in and make the background go faster.
Yeah, and when they went, they did do the one CGI motor where you got to be the NOS.
Oh yeah, yeah, right. I forgot about that.
That was a bad decision.
I'm so used to being the NOS that it just like swept right over me. I didn't even notice.
You're in the zone when that happens.
Yeah. I could see the carburetor.
Go right through the piston there in like a sort of a bad VGA sort of way.
I like that the Paul Walker character, Brian, this story's very, and I think this is another reason I brought up the sort of, I'm really straining for a homosexual content or undertone to this, or at least a queer undertone to this, because like, man, those two are in love. This is the story of like two guys falling in love and really just abandoning like Brian, a police officer. He really, for the sake of honor and my bro, I'm gonna fucking commit a major. I don't know if it's a federal felony, but that like he just throws it all out the window. He's just I'm not gonna sniff.
He should be in prison. Yeah. And yeah, for something. He'll never work again.
Yeah. I got a question for you. Did you watch the after credits scene?
No.
There's an after credits, my friend. And it's just like what Vin gets, you know, it's like the future of Vin and the final word of Dominic. It puts a nice cap on the movie, which, you know, like pretty clearly indicates it's not going to be a sequel. I guess it's still open, but it's a nice ending to Dominic's story. But you don't get a nice ending to Brian's story.
No, Brian's completely screwed.
Yeah.
I know we didn't, you know, we haven't dipped into the Too Fast, Too Furious to see how he enters the crime world and just becomes a part of Dominic's family up to and including marrying his sister. Even though really, let's face it, he wants to marry Vin Diesel.
Yeah, well, they're married through the heat of battle. You know, like it's just homosocial.
And they really discard their significant female girlfriends at different parts of the movie too. Like,
yeah,
Vin even sends his buddy back to get his girlfriend from who nearly died in a car crash. Michelle Rodriguez is dead on the side of the road, and Vin has more pressing matters, like how his bro betrayed him.
Yeah, well, I think it... Okay, well, I'll be a little more... not wrong. Actually, that moment when it's finally revealed, like, they're so good about the revelation, like, it's right at the end. When Brian tells Mia, you know, like, I'm a cop. And he's just like, I'm a cop. And he just, like, unveils everything. And then he does it in front of Vin. And I really, that moment, he doesn't punch him. There's nothing stereotypical about it. It's just like and I think this is where what you described comes in. Vin becomes Dominic in that moment. And it's a genuine moment of hurt. It's a genuine moment of anger. And then also worrying about, my bro, because he's on the ground, he's bleeding out.
Yeah, and he doesn't react though. Like but you can. It's like his reaction's like visceral, but like he doesn't do any. Like there's no action. It's just his pure reaction, and it's really frightening and odd, and it's maybe it could be historically the worst breakup I've ever seen.
But then after that, they get back together.
Yeah. All they need is a good race. They need the muscle.
Yeah,
cut.
Yeah. Yeah.
They need the biggest phallus.
I really like
for the reunion.
Yeah. But it was, I think it was smart. Like it's a real smart and kind of a funny thing to do at the end of this movie. Like they race and they get past that oncoming train, you know, like they both embrace the fucking G's or whatever, and they make it, and then they're fucking practically jerking each other off, and Vin Diesel gets like distracted and he gets sideswiped, and like for all intents and purposes, that's the end of the movie. And I was thinking, like, as they were driving and looking at each other, I was like, look at the road. And it was really satisfying for me to see him get hit. And it made a lot of sense. And it just did something like, imagine they didn't get hit and they just like drove. And then what? They just stand there, shake hands and leave.
Well, that's kind of the fun thing about like making those little side, like a small side swerve like that to ground something in reality. Like what would happen if you bromanced so hard that you didn't look at the road? You'd crash. And it's kind of like in an Alien movie when Ellen Ripley says, hey, we have a fucking quarantine procedure, you know. You all, as a viewing audience member, you're like, thank you, you know.
Yeah. Thanks. And now I can go back into fantasy. You know, I just need to like that moment of that little moment of reality to like, oh, okay, everything's above board here. And then they fucking, for all intents and purposes, kiss each other in the form of exchanging a red car. And then, I'll see you later, you know.
That's right. The 10-second car.
Yeah, yeah. I owe you a 10-second car. And I'd like... I was just really charmed by the ending because like that's a callback to the beginning of the movie. And I love a fucking callback. You give me a callback at the end of the movie and more 9 times out of 10, I'm going to be fist pumping.
You're going to be like, this is perfect. Full circle.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what I want. I remember really liking that about the first Pirates of the Caribbean. I was really pleased with the structure of that movie, even though like, fuck that movie. It was charming and it had a, like whatever happened at the beginning, it came to fruition or something related to it happened at the end. And everything in between was, you know, it was, there was action. And I was like, all right, great. So I think this movie kind of, I'm going to give it the Pirates of the Caribbean check mark.
I like that. Yeah. That's a thumbs up.
Yeah. So getting ready to be Ebert, huh, there, pal?
Yeah. I feel like that. I was channeling.
Die, screw you, motherfucker.
We're going back in time. 1996. The Long Kiss Goodnight.
Yes.
Directed by Rennie Harlan, who was married to Gina Davis at that time. They would subsequently get divorced. And then written by Shane Black, who brought you all the Lethal Weapon movies, as well as the script for Last Action Hero and Last Boy Scout and the Monster Squad.
Oh, I love the Monster Squad.
Yeah? You've seen Monster Squad?
I watched Monster Squad recently, yeah.
Wolfman's got nards.
This was great. It really took a real turn after the car crash.
Yes. Yeah. So, I don't know, for anyone with Fast and the Furious, I didn't worry about whether or not people had seen the movie, because it really doesn't. It's kind of doesn't matter. But basically, Gina Davis plays someone who's an amnesiac, but in fact, she's a super spy or a fucking contract killer. Like, what do we want to call her? Black ops murderer.
Right. Which actually, yep. Like, is kind of like True Lies or something. Actually, I felt like this had a lot of similarities with True Lies, but like the plot synopsis is fairly mundane from the product you actually get here.
Yes.
This is grotesque and ultra-violent and like deeply disturbing.
Yeah, I remember. So there's a scene, my recollection of the movie, I'd seen it long ago. Had you ever seen this movie before?
No, actually. No. Never saw it. I don't know how it passed me by. But
I can see why it would, though, because like for the first little while, it's not much of a movie. Like they really do. It's a Shane Black movie, so it takes place at Christmas. And, you know,
I like that touch.
It never fails him. Like all of his movies, it's all about Christmas, and it's always charming. I don't know how he does it. It's just like you get the sense that there's a darkness in the past, and they give like a film noir opening to the movie. But then for like a good 20 minutes, it's just her being a mom.
There's some pieces kind of falling into place, you know, while that's happening, but you don't get any indication of the severity that this thing's going to take.
Yeah. After that, she fucking breaks that deer's neck, just out of instinct.
Yeah. Oh, that's shocking. I think that's where Kate tuned in.
You know who really, Cynthia really liked this movie too. Like she didn't, I just kind of put it on in the background, I rewatched it a little while ago, and I was just, you know, I put it on in the background while she was doing something, and I didn't think she'd give a shit. And then very quickly she found herself interested. It's about a story about her. This sounds fucking sexist. It's a story about a mom and her kid. You know, it's a search for identity, and these things. They're not toxically masculine, and so they're a way in. And then this story will slowly take you towards, like, essentially, Gina Davis's character is your fucking black ops tough guy, wants to fuck, wants to kill, and that's buried beneath her, her troubled nice mom exterior.
Yeah, which is horrific.
Yes,
and Samuel Jackson ends up being kind of the. He actually sort of is the female role later on in the movie.
That's true. Yeah, he's for all intents. Yeah,
stereotypically speaking, like for like a, it's like a genre bender, you know, kind of.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
We take this, we'll turn it into a spy thriller. We'll make this amnesia candidate be like basically the Arnold Schwarzenegger of commando spies or whatever, but then we'll twist her tough guy criminal partner or whatever into kind of like a subsidiary role or whatever.
Yeah, he's
a good dad. Traditionally also.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, he.
Oh, he's trying.
Yeah, I don't think you're wrong. I think he is meant to sort of stand in for the what would be within the jar, the normal female accomplice or sidekick or something like that. And at one point, yeah, she tries to have sex with him. But he turns the tide by showing a picture of a child. So there's this concept of motherliness and parental duty that sits at the back of this movie, and kind of disciplines it, and allows the whatever the plot is, it only goes forward as a consequence of that fact. And I think that is part of the. That's part of the interest. Like, that's why I think this is a good movie.
Charm. It's true. It raises the bar. Like that's what raises the stakes for your protagonist. Like, after she turns into like an evil black ops, like when after whatever the spoiler, she gets tortured and goes in that water wheel.
Oh, we got to talk about that though. Yeah, that was awesome.
That was epic. But that's where she really that's where her amnesia really lifts, and she. Does like a complete role swap into the spy completely. Mm-hmm. The only way for you to stay empathetic to the character is to hope that she could come back and be a mom, you know?
Yeah. Cause you grew to really like Samantha Cain, this deep cover that had managed to acquire its own life. And Jackson, his character immediately recognizes that and notices that the Charlie character had thrown away a picture of the daughter or something. And so he keeps it, and he just makes sure that aspect of her doesn't disappear. Lots of dynamics, but that torture scene, I remember that being the end of the movie. And I was really surprised to see that's halfway through the movie. Like, almost exactly.
By the way, for somebody that doesn't like long movies, I was like halfway nodding off at like 1 a.m. the other night. Because it was very long.
It's 2 hours and 10 minutes long, yeah. It's, I didn't remember it being that long.
It was, I don't know. It was great. The Sam Jackson character was... kind of like, I don't know, his dynamic grew and changed, and then I just found the really cool part was after your really favorite torture scene.
I just like the point where she's like she finally breaks and she's like, I need a bath, she's just like really fucking hardcore, and you immediately get the sense that prior to that she, and this goes to Gina Davis, I suppose. She's terrified prior to that. She's shaking. And then she makes the switch over to also shaking, but still a different character completely. And you get the sense of her, of how terrifying she could be. Because that's not a good place to be. And then she's not afraid.
She was really scary. Her role flip was absolutely frightening. She was unrecognizable. And it was really, really impressive range, which actually, going back, we cracked a gag about in the previous episode of the X-tinction Agenda with the Fly review. The Cronenberg special. One of us made a shot at Gina Davis only being Gina Davis.
That was
other
me.
Roles. Yeah, so I don't know if this was specifically
I'm gonna say that I'm still
to dip
right
your
about
toes
that.
Into that. I don't think so, man. I don't know. I think there's a lot of range that just happened in that movie.
Yeah, but I'm gonna say she comes up, she goes into the water, motherly, frightened, cold Gina Davis, and then she comes out of the water, angry, focused, unafraid, cold Gina Davis. You know, she doesn't stop being that person. It's just the Brad Pitt syndrome. It's the George Clooney syndrome. Like they beneath the fact that they are who they are, there's some range there. And there's some skill, but I think she just falls in that category.
Also, can we talk about Gina Davis's guns? What?
We're talking about her breasts or her guns?
Arms.
Her arms. Okay, all right.
Arms were gigantic, man. She had to be. I'm convinced she trained.
Oh, she must have.
Because she was frightening. Like there's just like I don't know. There are women sometimes in action roles and movie roles that can be. They can be like frightening and believable, and a lot of that has to do with stature and actual height. And Gina Davis is one of them. Like, I believe that she could fight a man in that movie, and it was terrifying.
I wonder how tall she is.
Nah, she's over 6 feet. She's got to be right there.
She's a giant.
It's like Sigourney Weaver when Sigourney Weaver grabs Paul Reiser and shakes him like a baby. that actually is believable. She's terrifying. In the movie Aliens, but then I also think of now I'm going to be mean. I'm going to say Charlize Theron, who also has a terrifying stature and demeanor, but physically, in a fighting movie, which they did one called Atomic Blonde, like an action.
I saw John Wick
type of thing. I don't find her believable. Physically, I don't feel like she has the same strength and movement, you know, as some other female leads. Same thing with Scarlett Johansson. I don't believe Scarlett Johansson could fight her way out of a paper bag, and she doesn't display it in any way.
I'm gonna agree with you about ScarJo. Well, I'm thinking about her at the beginning in Prometheus. Doing those push-ups, and I'm thinking about her in Mad Max. Yeah.
Okay.
I don't.
Those. But Prometheus. Prometheus Charlie scares me.
Yeah, I don't think stature is the problem in the case of her. I'm going to chalk that up to bad. It's not even bad choreography. It's just like a style of choreography. Like when she throws the rope, and like it's very. It's very like you got to be fucking Jet Li to pull that shit off.
Yeah, like, he was trying to go John Woo, and he could have kept her like a big scary Punisher type and probably been okay.
Yeah. And I think it's just kind of a mismatch. I'm not going to write her off like you perhaps have.
I'm sorry to lump her in with ScarJo.
Just don't put her with ScarJo, dude. That is not fair. I suppose maybe the last thing I wanted to bring up about this movie was like the escalating tension of the final action. Like you talk about the Uzi scene when she's like riding up and she fucking shoots the helicopter and shit like that.
Oh, I was talking about when she machine gunned the ice.
Oh, that's cool too.
That was really sick. Okay, all right. I was like, now we're talking.
Jumps out that window and like makes a soft landing that way.
Yeah.
I was thinking about the final. Okay, so you've got a bomb. So you've already got the tension of like a bomb with a timer, and so Shane Black is thinking like, okay, how do we make that more exciting? Let's have the bomb rolling down a hill, or attached to a truck that can't be stopped, and then now what? Okay, so a couple moments in, oh, you're gonna hit the brakes, and for no reason the brake line is gonna break, and it'll squirt everywhere, and the brakes don't stop working for no good reason, and you're like, and it just keeps. He's really good at just making a bad situation worse and worse and worse until it seems like there's the heroes can't win, and then giving them a win. Kind of a funny and exciting win. That's really important to his skill set.
Well, that was really cool because that happened with the truck, and then she basically finally, you waited for the whole movie for her to crack and just be a bit of a mother. Mm-hmm. You know, and she sets her daughter off. Run, don't look back. That's my girl, right. You know?
Yeah,
and basically
yeah.
just dies on the ground. Then you escalate the loss again because she comes back. Wake up, mommy. Don't
yes,
be a baby.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And then another like, callback to the beginning of the movie. So he just makes it greater and greater. And then he gives it the stereotypical action movie ending. Die
yeah,
screaming. Yeah.
Really cool ending. Yeah. Yeah. Boss. We had some really great motherfucker lines from Sam Jackson.
I can't be killed.
Amazing. Amazing. Yeah. Yeah. With that horrible slimy blood from like... He did like the old bright red blood from like internal organ bleeding or whatever.
Jesus. Yeah, he was not in a good way.
Yeah, it was awesome. I thought he was going to die. But
now all we need is a little energon and a lot of luck.